ברוך השם, תנאי לזה ראש חודש אדר, מי שנכנס אדר, מרבים בשמחה. חבר'ה, the song has ruined some people's understanding of this word. There is no word מי שנכנס אדר. That means whoever enters אדר. The word is מי שנכנס אדר. From when אדר enters, מרבים בשמחה, we increase our joy. I think what else can increase the joy? As much as learning the written Torah. And so for the Musar part of the classes, from now until Purim, Bezrat Hashem, we will be studying Megillat Esther through the writings of Rabbi Yonatan Yosef. Rabbi Yosef left behind a commentary on Megillat Esther, and we'll be using the Chumashim on page 1252. And every Pasuk, I'll read to you the comments that he wrote on that Pasuk. This way, when you come to Purim, you have an actual understanding of what happened here in the story of Purim, not just what I read in front of my face, but also what the Chachamim say in each place. Vahi bimei Achashverosh, page 1252. It was in the days of Achashverosh. Hu Achashverosh, he is Achashverosh, hamolech mihodu ve'ad Kush. He's the king from Hodu until the place called Kush. Some could understand this to mean from India till Africa. Meaning, the king of the whole world. Sheva ve'esrim u'mea medina. Sheva is?
Seven.
Islim?
Seven.
20?
Oh.
Umea?
Oh, yes.
100.
100. 127 countries. Bayamim ahem, in those days, Keshevet HaMelech HaChashverosh HaKisem Bakudo, on the days where HaChashverosh sat on his royal throne, Asher b'Shushan Habira, which was in a city called Shushan. Shushan has a name in the Iran today, it's called, anyone know?
Aleppo.
We have some people in our community from there. Hamadan, it's called. Hamadan. That is Shushan.
It's an oil town.
Vahi b'mei HaChashverosh. There's two different midrashim who was Achashverosh. Rabbi Yonatan Yosef brings both of them. Amru Chazal, the rabbis tell us in Yalkut Shimoni. Oto laila shnehrag Belshazzar al yedei Daryavesh v'Koresh. That same night when Belshazzar was murdered by Daryavesh and Koresh, Amar lo Daryavesh l'Koresh. Daryavesh, they call him Darius in English, told Koresh, Amod, stand up. V'tol malchutcha, and take over the kingdom, shata ruwi l'malchut, because you are fitting to be king. V'daryavesh havi madi v'choresh parsi. Daryavesh was from the people of Madai, and Choresh was from the people of Persia. V'oto laila haya mesev daryavesh al kiseh malchuto shebelshazzar, and that night Daryavesh rested on the throne of Belshazzar, who they just overthrew now. ונפלה ערבוביה בין חיילי כזדים, and the soldiers got mixed up who's who, והייתה חרב איש ברעהו, and they started fighting each other. Their own soldiers, this happens sometimes, unfortunately. People fall in what they call friendly fire. ושתי הייתה ביתו של בלשצר. ושתי was the daughter of בלשצר. וכשראתה ערבוביה בין החיילים, and when she saw the soldiers fighting, ירדה נפשה, she got scared. ורצה עד כיסא המלכות, and she ran to the throne. Why did she run to the throne?
To be protected.
She thought that her father was alive and sitting on the throne. And she finds herself in the arms of none other than Daryavesh, who is the one who killed her father. And he had compassion over her. Yalkut Shimoni says, and he gave her to a wife, to his son Achashverosh. And that's where the story of Purim begins, according to the Midrash called Yalkut Shimoni. Says Rabbi Yonatan Yosef, "V'nirah shemidrash hazeh cholek al mashu darshu." This Midrash seems to contradict another Midrash that we have. Found in Talmud Megillah, chapter 11. "Hamolech mihodu v'ad kush." What does it mean? Achashverosh ruled from Hodu until Kush. "Shemalach me'atzmo." That he became king on his own. Shelo haya ra'uy l'malchut. He wasn't actually fit to be a king. He wasn't from royal lineage. Umamon rav natan lesarei hamlucha v'chtiru l'melech, and he gave a lot of money to be crowned king. ומוכח שלא היה מזרע מלוכה. Says Rabbi Yonatan Halevy, from what it says in the Talmud that we have, Achashverosh is not from the royal family.
So he bought this one.
וכן פירש רשי, and that's what Rashi explains, the same way. So there are two contradicting midrashim. Either Achashverosh is the son of Daryavesh, and he therefore becomes the king because they overthrew Belshazzar, or Achashverosh is a nobody who buys the royal throne with a lot of money. Now that fits in very well into the story here, which is why he marries Vashti. Mm-hmm. According to this understanding, he marries Vashti to have some kind of royal claim to the throne. The Malbim, and I don't recommend using the Malbim extensively. His commentaries are, he's a big Tamichan, the commentaries are good, but they're not always according to the Pshat. But here he says something interesting according to the Pshat. He theorizes that this is the reason why Achashverosh is in the city of Shushan. He proves that that was not actually the capital of the Persian kingdom. But Achashverosh, because he couldn't take over, you know, Washington, D.C., he had to take over another city and make it the capital of his kingdom. And part of that is because he's not actually worthy of the royal throne that he's in. Which only shows you the silliness of Achashverosh. According to the second Midrash, if he's killing Vashti, he's essentially killing or getting rid of, whatever you understand the story, he's getting rid of his only actual legitimate claim to the royal throne. And that's part of Achashverosh's ultimate downfall. But not for me. Now I'll do the Midrashim. I'm not going there. I want to stick my mash in the next month and a half to what Rabbi Yonatan Halevy himself writes. Vahi b'mei Achashverosh. B'mgila ita, in Masechet Megillah, page 10, it says, Amar Rav Ashi says, Kol makom shenemar vahi b'mei, any time you find in the Tanakh that it says vahi b'mei, and it was in the days of, Eno eda lashon tzar, is only going to bring bad news afterwards. Vahi b'mei Achashverosh, vahi b'mei Noach. Every time you see these words, vahi b'mei, following after,
run for your life.
Yeah, bad things. יש לפרש על פי מה שאמרו פסחים, מהי דכתיב, צדקות פרזונו בישראל, אמר רבו שאל בשעה says, צדקה עשה הקדוש ברוך הוא לישראל. Hashem did a great kindness to the Jewish people, שפיזר אותם בכל מדינות העולם, that he scattered us among all the nations of the world. וזהו שאמר שר אחד, why did it a good thing that he scattered us among the nations of the world?
Because we could survive, if not in one place, another.
Very good. If they would kill us in one place, at least we would survive as a people in another place. וזהו שאמר שר אחד מין, and that's what one Christian officer, מין, that's from the early Christians, clearly was in cahoots with the Romans. That's what he told רבי חנינה. אנחנו טובים והגונים מכם, we are better human beings than you Jews are. שהרי כמה שנים אתם חוסים בצילנו ובמדינתנו, look how many years you're resting in our presence under our occupation. ואין אנחנו פוגעים בכם כלל, and we're not hurting you at all. בניגוד למה שעשה יואב בן צרויה, you remember יואב בן צרויה in the Tanakh? He was the general of?
Oh, David.
Very good. Very good. שחרית כל זכר באדום, that he wiped out every male in Edom, in the Christians, meaning that nation. No, they were not actually Christians. נטפל לו רבי הושעיה, tells him, אמר לו, מה שאין אתם פוגעים בנו, that which you're not killing us, זהו משום שאין אתם יודעים מה לעשות איתנו, because you don't know what to do with us. Because if you were to decree to wipe out the Jewish people, and kol Yisrael b'shutchem, not all the Jewish people are under your Roman occupation. Shareihem fuzarim b'chol medinat ha'olam, because we're all over the world. V'im tifgeu rak be'elu shehem b'medinatchem, and if you try to kill only the Jews in your country, yikeru lachem ha'omot b'chol medinot malchuta k'ti'ata. All the nations of the world will call you a genocidal nation, a nation that kills people. שידע כתועם לעשות כל זממה. Really, that's not what he translated. That you're a pathetic nation. Look, you try to kill the Jews, but you could only kill the Jews in your country. You couldn't even get all the Jews in the whole world. ומעתה, now, לגבי אחשוורוש, שמלך כמעט מסוף העולם ועד סופו, אחשוורוש reigns from one side of the world to the other, 27 מהמדינה, 127 countries, אילו חס ושלום התקיימה גזירתו להשמיד הרוג לבית כל יהודים, הייתה צעה גדולה. If Achashverosh was successful, he could have killed all the Jews in the whole world. Because he controlled the whole world. שלא היה נשאר מהם שריד ופליד, there would be nothing left for the Jewish people. הלכך, והיא בימי, נועד לשון צער. That's why the Megillah starts with the words, והיא בימי, it was in the days of. Terrible things could have happened. This is unlike any other antagonist to the Jewish people. Even Hitler, when he came to attack us, he didn't rule the whole world. He tried. His hope was to rule the whole world, but he couldn't do that. He couldn't accomplish that. Which meant that even though he could deal a terrible blow to Am Yisrael, but there were parts of Am Yisrael that he could not touch.
They tried, right?
They tried hard.
He had a plan for America.
Yeah.
Achashverosh, he had that ability. He had that potential. He could have hurt all of us. And because of that, the Megillah starts with the words, Vayhibimei. And it was in the days of Hu Achashverosh. What does it mean? He is Achashverosh. Vayhibimei Achashverosh, Hu Achashverosh. It was in the days of Achashverosh, he is Achashverosh. Why does it have to say that twice? It must come to tell you something. Amru Chazal, our rabbis tell us, Hu Birish'o Mitchilato Ve'al Sofo. He is the same Achashverosh who was wicked in the beginning until the day he died. He was a wicked man his whole life. Achashverosh is a no good person. Nebuchadnezzar echived Beit HaMikdash. Nebuchadnezzar destroyed the temple. והוא ביקש להחריב את יסודות בניינו שלמה ובמלכות הרשבוש בתחילת מלכותו כתבו שטנה על יושבי יהודה וירושלים.
It's amazing we have the situation with Persia to the present day.
It's a nation that's always been an aggressor to us. He said, Nebuchadnezzar destroyed the Beit HaMikdash, and right away, you know, the Jewish people started building the Beit HaMikdash again. Achashverosh made sure that wouldn't happen, like it says in the Midrash. Nasu b'tchifut Yerushalayim, that Achashverosh sent people to Yerushalayim, uvitlu b'koach va'el et avodat b'Beit HaMikdash, and they interrupted the rebuilding of the Beit HaMikdash. V'nishara b'tila avodat shnat shtayim l'malchut Dariyavesh, b'nosh Achashverosh Mester Malkah. And the only time the temple started to be constructed again was many years later, when Dariavesh, the second, not the first one, the second one, who was he? The son of Achashverosh. Who was he? The son of Achashverosh with Queen Esther. He lets the Jewish people go back to Eretz Israel and build a Beit HaMikdash.
Is that what they call Cyrus?
I don't know what they call it in English. Lachen amu alav, that's why we say about him, Hu birisho mitchado v'atzofo, שאחשברוש היה שונא ישראל עוד יותר מהמן. אחשברוש hated the Jewish people more than Haman hated the Jewish people. Many people read the Megillah incorrectly. They don't understand the characters of the Megillah properly. I'm not here to talk about pop Judaism, but street Judaism of the last few years has brought out certain people in the Tanakh as heroes when they were never heroes. For example, the latest trend seems to be to push Vashti as the hero of the Megillah. You may think that I'm joking, that I'm making it up, but I read an article recently, a whole concocted article, how Vashti was really the first woman who ever stood up to a man. She was the first feminist. And she gets banished from the kingdom because of women's rights. Because she's not willing to give in to the depraved sickness of men. And then what happens, listen, the author continues, and I thought it was just one crazy person, but as I started asking around, this has already became a trend. Some people, they're giving their bat mitzvah speech about Vashti. She's the heroine now. Esther, the queen, listen to this, they painted out Esther. Esther is going to the king. And she's struggling, Esther. Not me, I'm not saying this, they're saying this. Esther is struggling because she's being forced to listen to a man also. Mordechai. He's also an oppressive man.
Oh, please. Come on.
And Esther has to figure out how does she not make the same mistake that Vashti makes. Giving in to a man and his will.
Oh, please.
And really, even though Esther comes out of the Megillah, the real heroine of the Megillah is Vashti. You think I'm making it up? Go tonight. Go home and Google Vashti, hero, and you'll be blown away. Vashti hated Am Yisrael. Vashti used to torture Jewish women. Somehow she became the heroine for people who don't know how to read. Achashverosh is not this buffoon who's sitting in Shushan and Haman is playing him. Achashverosh hates the Jews just as much as Haman, if not more, according to Achamim. But like any good leader, he doesn't want to get his hands dirty. Why get someone else to get his dirty work done for him? He plays like he is neutral. But he's just getting hit. Why should I get involved if someone else is already doing the work for me? Let's go back to the Psukim, the third Pasuk. Bishnat Shalosh Lemalcho. It was the third year of the kingdom of Achashverosh. Asa Mishte Lechol Sarah Ve'Avadav. He made a feast for all of his ministers and his servants. Chel, Paras, Umadai, Apartemim, Vasarei, Midot, Vanav, all the royalty and the famous people, all of them came to this party. Mishnah Shalosh Mokho, says Rabbi Yosef, what does it mean, Mishnah Shalosh Mokho, the third year of his kingdom? Amru Chazal, our rabbis tell us, Shechashav Umana Achashverosh et Shnot Achuban. Achashverosh did the math from the years of the destruction of the Ben HaMikdash. Shnodalo, it became known to him, Shehanavi Gazar Omer Lemalot Techuvot Yerushalayim 70 Shana. Daniel, in the 9th chapter, the prophet tells us that Jerusalem will be destroyed for 70 years. Ve'az Yifkod Hashem Et Amo Ligolotam, and after 70 years, Hashem would come back and redeem the Jewish people. Ve'livnot Bet Midrash, to rebuild the temple. Ulefi Cheshbono Nigmeru Az 70 Shana. And according to the calculations of Achashverosh, he thought that 70 years had already passed. And he saw the Jewish people were not safe. So he said to himself, because the Jewish people have not been redeemed, for sure the prophecy of the prophet will not come true. In general, that even those who hate us believe, or at least they're concerned about the prophecies that we may have. You have dramatic scenes of Titus after destroying the Beit HaMikdash, screaming at Hashem, look, I killed your people. Either you believe in Hashem or you don't. How can you believe in Hashem and kill his people? Because it's something that exists. The same Christians who murdered us for years and years and years and years believe in our Tanakh.
Yeah.
All those prophets that they mentioned, they would have killed them too.
Mm.
It's a strange world. We never could wrap our heads around how they could have two faces. How you could believe in that and the chosen people and still kill the chosen people.
And kings of Israel killed prophets.
That's right. That's even worse. Me'asa, so what did he do? Once he saw the 70 years had passed, he felt that he was in the clear. Hotzit klei bet mikdash. He took out all the utensils from the bet mikdash, the gold, the silver, whatever we had. How did he get them? Nebuchadnezzar, when he destroyed the temple, he brought them. V'nishtamesh behem b'mishtei ha'yayin, and he used them for this royal feast. Lefichach ba'satan v'riket b'nehem v'nargav vashti. And that's the Chachamim say, like as a consequence for that, the Satan came and got Achashverosh drunk. He ends up killing his wife. This whole story happens almost as a retribution for Achashverosh taunting HaKadosh Baruch Hu with the vessels of the Ben Mikdash. This idea of using the vessel of the Ben Mikdash, you find this with all of the antagonists who antagonize the Jewish people. You know, the Nazis, Yimach Shem Zichron, it wasn't enough that they killed us. That wasn't enough for them. They tortured us and murdered us and it all began with burning Jewish books, destroying Jewish, humiliating the Jewish people for what was holy to them. Destroying Bate Knesset, synagogues. Wherever you find, now this week, three Arabs in Yerushalayim broke into a synagogue and threw the Sifrei Torah on the ground and poured acid all over them.
They found the people who did
it? They found some kind of security footage. I don't know if they caught them yet or not, but they, you know, it's not bad enough you stamp us on the streets, you blow us up in shopping centers and pizza stores. Also, the Torah has to go to this. Even that you can't leave alone. Even that can't be enough. The Tzorim, the enemies of Am Yisrael, always find not just to attack us physically, but also to attack us in the things that are holy to us, to turn from things that are sacred, to make them, to desecrate them. To take the utensils of the Ben Mikdash. You can imagine the Jewish people are in exile. The only remnants that we have of our glorious time in Eretz Israel are the things that we have for the Ben Mikdash. 70 years is not so long. There are probably Jews who are living then that remember what it was like when the Ben Mikdash was still standing. To take out those gold and silver utensils, that only the high priest, the Kohen Gadol, used them on Yom Kippurim, and to eat the steak with it, to serve French fries on it. You can imagine the humiliation that Am Yisrael went through. Achashverosh is not over and over. We have to drive this point in. Achashverosh is not stupid. everything. We make him out like some buffoon. Like, Mamai doesn't know anything. He's just a fool. He is a malicious, evil person whose whole intent is to break the Jewish people. He's just lucky that he has a fool like Haman who works for him. Haman is willing to get his hands dirty. But Ahasuerus is no less evil than anyone else. I'm going to stop here for tonight. Tomorrow we'll do Pasuk Dalet 4. We want to talk a little bit about the HaShamayim showing off his wealth. Where did the HaShamayim even get wealth from? If he's just a commoner who became a king, where did all that money come from?
Ooh.
Tomorrow.